Okay, folks, ladies and gentlemen, we've got in the studio, as I know you've heard already, the illustrious Taylor Haynes, who is running for governor, coming up real quick in the next election. Taylor, it's a pleasure to have you on the program, sir.
It's a pleasure to be here, Bruce. Thanks for having me.
So, talk to us about your adventure you're in. You have certainly seen the state of the state. You've said, hey, look, I can make this a better place. I can contribute. Talk to us about why you're running and what you're thinking about.
Well, to make this a better place, it's a we kind of thing. And I'm going to bring government by the people back as well as of and for the people. And by getting out around the state and actually having people talk to me about their concerns, it's given me a much clearer picture of where our public is with their understanding of how their government runs versus how it should run, and a chance to have that exchange. And also that they really want a constitutional-based government where they know they can trust the government because we're going to go by the Constitution. The state of our state right now is decent economically because of our mineral wealth, but it's greatly threatened because of the overreach of the federal government. It's also greatly threatened because the legislature in the last election went off the rails and violated the Constitution and destroyed the Department of Education. And we have Common Core now on the ground in Wyoming. And I'll tell you, Common Core removes all local control, all local input, and gives you a one-size-fits-all. And there's some things left out of Common Core that should terrify people. But because they seem innocuous, I haven't heard many people talk about it. Let's talk about the loss of art training in elementary school. Well, come on, Taylor. What's art training in elementary school? Well, I'll tell you what it is. It starts an individual off as a child with the idea that he can create. He or she can have an idea and put it on paper, and it's whatever they want to do. Well, as we go down through education and they progress and they get formal math, science, language, they still have this idea that they can create. And the result of that is E equals MC squared. The result of that is the silicon chip. The result of that is we go to the moon with a slide rule. And so if we take that creativity away, we are training kids to be employees and automatons. We're not educating them to be creative, active, informed citizens. And so, having been blessed with an exceptional education, having been blessed by God with an exceptional professional career in engineering, medicine, ranching, which is natural resource-based industry, commodities, etc., my success is by the grace of God, and I know that because I've seen God do things at my hands that not only could I not do, no one else could either. And I've had successes, I've made decisions that, God, I don't know if this is going to work or not. And it turns out, not only did it worked beautifully, but not in the way I had planned. In fact, it worked in spite of what I had planned. So that's the hand of God. So I want to see Wyoming turn to God. I want to see Wyoming turn to the Constitution, and we will be free and prosperous.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Taylor Haynes, candidate for governor of Wyoming. If you'd like to call into the program, we've got one line that really will connect well, 632-6500. Again, that's 632-6500. If you'd like to pose a question to our good friend Taylor, we should, we'd like to take that. And I think we've got one, Taylor, right now. Go ahead. You are on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, good morning, Bruce. Good morning, Dr. Haynes.
Hey, good morning.
And good morning, John, if you're still out there. I listened to Dr. Haynes speak, and Dr. Haynes speaks the truth. I'll tell you the reason why. He's not a quick study when it comes down to the Constitution, the Federalist Papers, and the Articles of Confederation. You're going to have a lot of people that are going to get up there and run against him who do a quick study and think they know what it's all about, or tell the people this is what you ought to know about it, and that's it. But, Doctor, when you talk, I hear you speak the truth. I hear you speak about God and country. Not country and God, but God and country. And that's extremely important to me, because I see that being taken away from us on a daily basis. This Agenda 21, UDC codes, and the whole works, and what the city has agreed to do, and leave the old codes in position, is a... I really don't have words.
Caller, let me interject here. Listen, I personally, I agree with you. I appreciate your call. I agree with you on everything you're saying. Taylor is a man of immense character. Go ahead, Taylor.
Right on, Eric. God comes first, and he can fix these things. When you get away from that, like Bruce and I were talking during the break, you get 315 million opinions, and now you've got chaos. And that's how the things like the UDC gets in. We have city council bound and determined to violate the First Amendment, even though the city of Cheyenne lost a lawsuit, Williams versus the city of Cheyenne, right here in River City. So we'll have to do it again, and I know some people who are going to violate this, and then they're going to bring another lawsuit, and then maybe this particular city council will learn. But I will counsel them that it's not going to just be you lose, and now you have to accede to the Constitution. I would advise them to look at a constitutional case law decision called Owens versus the City of Independence, Missouri, where the city council members individually were held culpable. And people that get on boards need to realize they also have individual culpability. I don't mean that to be a threat. I mean that to be, that's a fact of life, that we have laws, and once the citizens bring the law down, sometimes there's consequences.
Yeah.
Caller, listen, we're going to move on real quick here so we can get more calls. We got one line.
One thing I have to say is that, you see, when it comes to we the people, we pay the salaries for those elected officials, and then we have to shell out to lawyers to fight them that using our money to fight us.
So right.
I'll hang up and listen.
That's a vicious cycle.
But you're right.
You're right. Appreciate the call. Thank you. And folks, if you got a question for Taylor, please call in. And frankly, Taylor, I've got kind of a question for you. What could you bring to the governor's office that nobody else can bring?
Well, as I've studied Wyoming since it became a state, the first thing that I find is something that's always been missing. We've not had a governor that ever stood up for states' rights under the Constitution. In other words, under the equal footing doctrine. And I will bring that to the office as well.
We've got a caller on the line. Go ahead. You are on the air.
Yes, good morning, Dr. Haynes. Good
morning.
Wanted to ask about Governor Mead some time back said that state government was getting smaller, but then we hear about the need to refurbish the Capitol, add five more stories to the Hersler building. They have the old Pioneer grocery store bought. You see state buildings all over town. How in the world is adding buildings going to help cut down on the number of employees and the overall government expense? It just doesn't seem possible to me, and if you could comment, why, that would be great.
Great question.
Well, I think you've answered your question. If we're building buildings and increasing capacity, clearly we're not just building empty warehouse space. So state government is not getting smaller. The thing that I plan to do, I plan to increase the workload for the existing state employees that we have, because we're going to run our whole state. We're going to get the benefit of all of our mineral wealth. But we will have a hiring freeze until that's on the ground and working well. If I were in the chair now, I would agree with maintaining the Capitol building. I've had experience with 130-year-old ranch house and 50, 75-year-old ranch houses. Yeah, there's some expense involved in keeping those up to date. But the additional office space, I would veto.
Very good. Appreciate that. Collie, do you have any other questions before we go?
Oh, yes. One of the things on the Capitol renovation is that the... whoever, and I forget who it was, I think it was a senator or representative, but anyway, they were saying that the wiring was all outdated, the sewer system, the bathrooms and so forth was all in disarray. Well, it seems to me like maybe somebody's been slacking off on overall maintenance and so forth. If that is the case, and I really haven't seen any people out behind the bushes around the Capitol building, so I don't know that they're they're that bad off. But anyway, I'll hang up and listen. Thank you, Dr. Haynes, and good luck in your campaign.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your phone call. Okay, what do you think?
Caller makes a great point about deferred maintenance. Deferred maintenance can get you in trouble because someday the chickens come home to roost all at once. Mm-hmm. And I think, I'm not aware of what all of the other state institutions do, but I know some have a maintenance schedule. And even when they build a new building, operation and maintenance is also baked into the initial cost estimate. And I think that's the best way to do it. Here we're going to have this facility. What's it cost to run it after we've built it? And now what do we need to do to maintain it? And what seems like the people in charge of state buildings probably have or should have some sort of maintenance schedule. And then we need to budget that. Legislature needs to be aware. But the caller makes a good point. This shouldn't all come at once as a big surprise.
Okay, we've got another caller on the line. Hello, you're on the John Frenthaway Show. You're on the air. Go ahead.
Morning, guys. Joe, Dr. Haynes, Wichita, the plumber. I had the pleasure of attending the Independent Cattlemen's Association meeting with you in Wright, Wyoming here about 2.5 years ago, I believe.
Great, thank you.
And I just am confused. As governor, what can you do about the onslaught of Agenda 21, the mayor, the city council, most of the city council, the vast majority of the county commissioners deny it. The mayor got reelected at denying it, and they're shoving it up our nose and out our ears and everywhere else. And, you know, is there something you'll be able to do to help, help slow this down or you become governor?
Yes. Now, let's set the ground rules. First of all, cities and counties that are incorporated have home rule, so they don't have to abide by whatever the legislature or the governor recommends. So, with that said, here's what I can do. See, when you're elected governor, you take an oath to uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States against enemies foreign and domestic. Now, that is a real short statement, but that is where the power is. Agenda 21, and for instance, the UDC codes passed in Cheyenne, I'm very familiar with those, violate the Constitution in many ways. Now, they pass those. And while they're just passed, there's not an issue. When a citizen has a problem directly related to that, they can bring that problem as a violation of their constitutional rights. Because their constitutional rights have been violated, then that opens the door for the governor to step in and enforce the Constitution. And that, unfortunately, is the avenue we'd have to take. Now, before we get to litigation and prosecution, which, if necessary, we will, then you get the mayors and the presidents of the city councils and county commissions in a conference about what the Constitution means, what the oath means, not only what their responsibilities are, but the penalties for violating that oath under Title 18 U.S. Code. And there is much constitutional case law, people prosecuted, people being fined and jailed, elected officials for violating those. So that is the approach the governor will have to take if they don't see the light and rescind these unconstitutional codes. That's really something I can promise you that I'll do, because I'm only running to enforce the Constitution and to turn our people back to God.
One more thing, sir. I'm kind of sad that you and Cindy Hill are going to be running against each other, but I'm encouraged because you two are the classiest people that have been on the political scene in a long time, will show everybody how to run a race on the issues without the mudslinging and the eye gouging and everything else. So I look forward to that. But so God be with you, and we will be praying with you and for you.
Well, thank you. God be with you, and God be with us all.
Appreciate your opinion. Thank you, caller.
Thank you.
Thank you much. We have got another caller on the other line. We're going to get you through. Hello, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Well, welcome to the program. Hello. Well,
thank you very much, and good morning, Dr. Haynes and, Mr. Hayes.
Hello.
I know that, Taylor, I know that you are very much for the Constitution that BLM land belongs to Wyoming. I just wondered, how are you going to garner support from our hunters and from our ranchers who lease that, the ranchers lease the land to run their cattle, and the hunters have access to that land if it's, if there's a road that they can get onto that. So would you tell me how you are planning to garner support from those two groups?
Well,
and I'm for you 100%.
Thank you very much.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Well, as the previous caller stated, the land actually belongs to Wyoming, and the federal land managers are running things at this point. Hunters, ranchers, public land users, natural resource producers that use public land will be much better off with that land in state hands. And as governor, that's what I will do. I will enforce the Constitution, and I will enforce the equal footing law. And there's much constitutional case law and Supreme Court decisions already made so that I can simply do that. And what the ranchers will see, their leases will continue. I have quite a bit of experience in that area, as many people know, and as I've observed what goes on now, I don't think they're running enough livestock to improve the range. I think they're just maintaining, and I think they will, down the road, look at an opportunity to increase their stocking rates and actually improve the range, and there's several techniques we will suggest that they employ. Hunters will be then guaranteed hunting access that they may not have if some other people have their way. We will have a few more roads because we need to maintain our forests and prevent wildfires and deal with the mountain pine beetle thing. So we're going to actively manage our forests, and I believe in multiple use, both recreation, natural resource production, and preservation. So I think everybody will be very pleased with how much more access and much more benefit they will get from our public lands when I'm governor.
Very well. We've got a caller on the line. Welcome to the John Frentheway Show. You are on the air. Hello.
Good morning. Good morning, Dr. Haynes. This is Lisa Glauner. How are you?
Good morning, Lisa. I'm great. Thank you for asking.
I'm going to jump back to the Common Core thing. And first of all, I want to express my gratitude to Dr. Haynes for even being aware of and especially opposed to Common Core. I called the Wyoming Department of Education a while back to verify that the state is trying to push for mandatory preschool, and they did verify that. And that's part of the expansion of the Capitol building. And then along with that, I was at the Select Committee of Accountability and Education meeting a few weeks back, and the Department of Education is asking to hire 16 new employees.
Well now, doesn't sound like state government shrinking.
No, it does not.
And I know from doing some legwork that there are three federal education employees now working directly in the Wyoming Department. And
that's,
so
that's correct. And they're not from within the state. They were hired outside the state.
That's right. Well, I will have to also have a lot of help from the people to get the legislature to stand up and do the right thing. But I have worked well with the legislature, and I am a person that engages people professionally and with respect. But I will also engage the public so that they understand what needs to be done. And then by the time we get to the legislative session, the legislators will have their marching orders from their constituents, and their governor, Taylor Haynes, will have his marching orders from the constituents, and we'll get this thing fixed.
Sounds good.
Dr. Haynes, how do you feel about...
Okay, ma'am, we're at the bottom of the hour.
Okay.
We're gonna, if you can hold if you'd like, but
no,
we've got to go
okay.
to the third break. Feel free to call back if you'd like.
The computer owns us.
Sometimes that is so true. Folks, you are listening to Taylor Haynes, and this is an opportunity to put a question to a man running for governor of the state of Wyoming. Feel free to take advantage of that. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that. The men who died, who died.
And welcome back, folks. You're listening to the John Fenthway Show. I'm Bruce, sitting in for John. Actually, I'm just kind of running the board. John will chime in a little later today. We've got a very special interview today. Taylor Haynes, who is running for governor of the great state of Wyoming. Taylor, welcome back. It's good to see you,
Bruce.
As always.
Yeah,
good to see you. You are generally a happy, smiling person. I just kind of lift it every time we get to
God
chat.
God is good. God is good, he so is. We should smile. And he's given us all the tools. We had two great questions during the break. First question was, where do I stand on the National Defense Authorization Act, and if I'm familiar with it? I am painfully familiar with it, and specifically Section 1021, which allows the president to instruct the military person to remove from the streets any American citizen he thinks poses a threat, and they can be detained in an unknown location until the end of the war on terrorism, which is, we all know, has no end, had no beginning, and has no end. Well, during the last legislative session, Kendall Croker brought a bill to, if should that happen in Wyoming, we would charge the perpetrator, whether it's a military person, police officer, anybody else that did that, we would charge them with kidnapping, and we would pursue them to the ends of the earth to enforce that. Well, that was killed in committee, but I would bring that back, and I will champion that around the state so that all the people understand what it means, and then they send their legislators to Cheyenne to pass that. And other unconstitutional acts. And the other question was, what about unlawful search and seizure without a court order? Well, clearly we're all against that. That violates the Fourth Amendment on its face. And therefore, we would also stand against that. And the way we do that is we bring the president of each county commission, and we bring the sheriff, the elected sheriff of each county, to a class on the Constitution. We would have that open to all comers, but we have to have those folks understand what the Constitution means, what their responsibilities are, and again, what the penalties are for not upholding that oath.
You know what? That sounds rather common sense to me, but
well, the Constitution is common sense, and as we were talking, Bruce, it's written at the eighth grade reading level so that all citizens can understand it. You don't need to be a lawyer, and you don't need this deep background in constitutional law. I've acquired that over my professional career out of self-defense.
Yeah, and that's the contradiction I've seen in our culture. On the one hand, the media would portray a view that you have to have a massively brilliant constitutional mind to dissect and tell the public what the Constitution really means, because that's the only place it's going to happen. Regular schmucks like, you know, all of us can't do it. And the opposite is true. And you know it's true because they teach it at some level. They teach
right.
it in school. And in Missouri, when I was growing up, it got covered twice. Once in 7th or 8th grade and once in high school.
Same in Louisiana when
Kay.
I grew up.
Okay, so if it was something only a constitutional scholar could dissect, then why in the heck teach it? Why don't we just settle for an oligarchy? Hey, 9 men on the Supreme Court will tell the entire country what to think. You know, because that's kind of what we're sliding into. We've got a caller on the line. Go ahead. You are on the air.
Yeah, I've been listening to you guys for a few minutes, and I just disagree with the fact that he says that the federal lands, the BLM lands,
yes.
is part of the state. That belongs to the people of the United States, the kids in Boston that don't own anything, the Buffalo. Everybody in the country owns that land. That's why it's federal. A state can be as small as Rhode Island. Our state is very big. I disagree that any state can control that much property.
Well, you can disagree, caller, but I would have
there's,
you.
There's something else, too. Across the country goes the UP Railroad, and along the tracks in patchwork, they don't touch continuously, and half of they go out 20 miles from the track. So the UP owns 10 miles on every side of the track, out 20 miles, and in between is the federal land. And that goes to 25 miles in 25 states. So half of that's private land, half of it's federal land, and the state has nothing to do with it, neither does the city.
Okay, let's hear Taylor's answer. Go ahead. What say you?
Well, that's incorrect. You see, when we come into the union, any state come into the union, you come in under the equal footing doctrine. And Hagen versus the United States is an Alabama case that proved that at the Supreme Court level. The UP was given in Wyoming every other section in some areas, but not in all areas, in exchange for bringing the railroad in. And the sections that they were given is UP land, it's private land. Federal land managers were offered to all of the states, big states like Texas, Wyoming, and Alaska, etc. Some states accepted them, and they've been here so long that now they call it federal land. But I've got mountains of Supreme Court decisions and other evidence where people have said, nope, you don't own this, the state's managing it. But you never see it in the media, so the people don't know. It doesn't belong to all of the people. This isn't the Soviet Union. We're not one big gamish. We're 50 separate sovereign states in a republic. We're not a democracy. We're a republic.
Okay, we've got another caller on the line who's been very patiently waiting. Go ahead. You're listening to KJB. You're on the air.
Yes, Dr. Haynes, I just wanted to tell you my support. I'm really thankful that you're running for governor. I look forward to hearing more from you. And one thing I did want to bring up today, because I did see you at the meeting, at the city council meeting a few, but I think it was the last one, the one before last, and you were there and made some comments about the sign issue, and one thing I wanted to ask you, because I'm not really sure, I was at the meeting as well, and one thing I didn't understand is, with regards to this First Amendment issue with the sign issue and the way the code currently reads, they were trying to pass a provision to make a change to that, and of course, as we know, four people voted against that, specifically the mayor, Georgia Boyles, Jim Brown, and Brian Cook. And if I'm not mistaken, any one of those individuals who voted no could ask for it to be represented back to the council. And so I would urge the people that are listening to contact those individuals. Again, the mayor, Mr. Cook, Georgia Boyles, Jim Brown, and ask them to bring it back for consideration because they were a no vote. One thing that was confusing to me was, the provision actually had a majority vote. It was 5-4, but the mayor said that it had to pass by six votes for it to pass, but they did that without one of their current members there. Jimmy Valdez was not there. I'm trying to understand, and maybe you can explain why it requires six votes, and is that with everything, or is it not a majority?
Well, I think it's in the statute for certain things that it's six votes, is my understanding. But you're making a tremendously important point that Mr. Valdez was unable to be there due to illness, and so we should ask those council people that voted against that to ask that to be brought back for reconsideration when Mr. Valdez is present. And I think it's very important to do that, because otherwise the city council is bound and determined to violate the First Amendment of the Constitution.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and the fact when, it seems very like it would be very difficult to get six votes on a lot of things, especially when you have a mayor that's not really concerned about constitutional rights, and you have the other three people, Brian Cook, Georgia Boyles, and Jim Brown, are very liberal in their views, obviously. I can see that being a problem, but I'm curious if it's only with UDC issues that it's a six-vote majority. I don't know, but and you may not be able to answer that either. I guess I need to do some research to find that out. But that's the point I wanted to get across, most importantly, was to urge people to contact those individuals and ask them, because Jimmy Valdez was not present, we did not have a full full group to bring it back for reconsideration and give him an opportunity to weigh in. One thing I also thought was interesting is you don't see too often where you have the Liberty Group, the Tea Party, and the ACLU all at the same place fighting for the same thing.
That's right. Very, very good important point.
Yeah, and when you see something like that, there is clearly an issue, and I just hope that the people in the community will get involved and contact those individuals, and hopefully we can make a change, because if we don't get involved, clearly our politicians are not going to do it for us.
That's right. Thank you so much for the call.
Appreciate it. What say you, Taylor? on that?
I say he's very right. We do need to have that brought back for reconsideration, where Mr. Valdez can weigh in and make his thoughts known, and then we can have a better vote.
We've got another caller on the line. Go ahead. You're on KJAB.
Well, happy Saturday from Skits.
Oh, hello, Skits.
Happy Saturday, Skits.
Hey, Taylor, all I got to say is I hope you either get to be governor or actually, better yet, a senator for Wyoming. I mean, yes, you got kind of an out-of-state cheering section for you here. If you want to, give Frank Smith a call, get my number for him, and I'll tell you what I did to my truck.
All right.
And hopefully I may be able to pass on something useful to you to get you in a good rig that'll last you a while.
Thank you.
All right. Well, hey, it's better to be a truth than a liar, and nobler to have and not need than to need and not have.
All sage truth. Say thank you. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Listen, Taylor, there was a lot of evidence in the national election, the last one we just had, of voter fraud. I mean, it's seemingly an endless list of very, very suspect circumstances, and the country decided not to pursue that. Do you believe that's an issue? Voter fraud is an issue in the state of Wyoming.
Well, the specter of voter fraud has been raised. I haven't seen any proof. And it is an issue if anybody raises the specter, so it has to be dealt with. And I think it could very simply be dealt with if we went to a paper ballot with a carbon copy, and you take the carbon home with you, so that if there is any suspicion, any reason to want a recall, everyone has their voting record.
You know, one of the things I really believe in my core is that a lot of our vaccine problems really do have simple solutions. We have a caller online. Go ahead. You are on the air, sir.
Yes, I'm calling back to Taylor because the 14th Amendment says that no state can enact or enforce any law violating the Constitution and rights of its citizens, including life, liberty, and property. That's property for all the states. I know Wyoming didn't buy the Louisiana.
Hello, you're...
Hello.
Go ahead.
Therefore, the state was just cut up out of that, and it was given state land and the federal land because it was so big. Same in Colorado. There's a McPhee branch down there that covered, went across the borders, and it was the largest ranch in the Colorado area. And the Rio Grande was part of this forest. So that was all private land. And by the Louisiana Purchase, we had to agree that we respect all the land grants that were given out by the kings in of different countries, or they wouldn't have bought it. And they only paid $7 million for the whole thing. Think about that. No state can enact or enforce any law. So you think the federal government's going to give up all that land to the states out here? This was set aside for a bread basket here. Mostly cattle, potatoes, and corn in Nebraska, potatoes in Iowa. These were the breadbasket states, not for development, but to feed the country. And they're cutting it up and selling the country with the UDC codes and all that stuff, stealing private land and building all over it. But if none of it's legal, and they're hurting all the people that do go there because it's not their land.
Taylor, what do you say to that?
Well, basically, you have to go back to the equal footing doctrine. If you go back to the Louisiana Purchase, we made certain agreements to honor land grants. But once the states became states, those land grants went away. And the reason those land grants went away is because there was no treaty. This was just a business deal. And there are no, if you read the Article 1, Section 8 of the United States Constitution, the federal government can only own 10 square miles of Washington, D.C., and they're only sovereign there and in the territories. They can't own any other land except forts, post roads, magazines, needful buildings. Needful buildings are buildings like the federal building here in Cheyenne, federal building in Casper. Under the Constitution, that's all they can own.
We've got another caller on the line. Thank you for calling into the John Frenthaway Show. You are connected. Go ahead.
Yeah, good morning. Taylor, I'd like to ask you a question.
Sure.
The EPA is going to run wild in 2014. It looks to me like, with the help of executive orders, they're going to all but shut down the state of Wyoming. Is there anything, I don't see anywhere in the Constitution that gives the EPA the power to come in and rule a state. And it looks to me like the legislature and the governor could do something about this.
That's right. Very simply. Very simply. Now, you made two very, very important points. There, in the Constitution, again, Article 1, Section 8, the federal government has very limited territorial powers. 10 square miles of Washington, D.C., and they're sovereign in the territories. Federal buildings, forts, magazines. When you bring up then the EPA, they have no authority to do anything in any state. And they get away with it because the governors and the legislatures roll over. And they roll over because of federal funds. That's why they roll over. And in large part, many of them don't know the Constitution. I've heard even of some high state officials who've bragged about never reading the Constitution or the 10th Amendment. Now, what could they do? Let's just say you don't need to go to court. Well, why not, Taylor? Okay, let's have people read Mack versus Prince, Supreme Court decision, and let's have people read Exner versus Georgia and New York versus the United States. Google those and read them. In all of those, it's pointed out that the federal government has no authority to dictate to the state legislatures. And then Judge Scalia in Mack versus Prince spelled out specifically in plain English that the EPA has no authority to act in the states. See, so it's already been litigated, adjudicated, and it upholds the Constitution. And so the governor, with or without the legislature, governor can say, okay, EPA, you have no authority to act. You're done acting in Wyoming. And then you say to your sheriffs, should they try to sanction or penalize or in any way interfere with any operator in the state, then they're arrested. And see, it's a simple, quiet thing. You're not in the streets. You don't need an armed revolution. You've already got a constitution and case law that takes care of that.
Yeah, it looks like the Constitution and the Bill of Rights protects us if we'll just learn to use it.
We have to exercise it just like to maintain your physical body. You have to have some exercise. You got to go to the gym a little bit, and we just haven't gone to the gym constitutionally for a while. But we can, while it's still on the books, while we still have many people like you and many people listening to this program who know that the Constitution is right and the grand law of the land. We just need somebody to stand up and enforce it.
Well, I that's what I thought. I just wish that we could do something about this Obamacare before it absolutely destroys health care in Wyoming, because that's what it's going to do.
That's exactly what it's going to do. And to that end, because I didn't win in 2010, it'll be on the ground to a greater extent by 2014. My wife and I run a third-party administrator, health care benefits, employee benefits company, and with her tremendous experience in plan design and my medical background, we're working on a plan that perhaps we can get away from that once I'm in office. We're looking at a plan whereby the people, the patients, subscribe to or work directly with physicians and institutions to provide their health care, and then we have to work out a system whereby when you travel out of our Wyoming system, that we can make sure you're covered on vacation and on business trips, etc., that kind of thing. It's not a simple thing, but we've got it about halfway worked out for Wyoming, and I've talked to a few physicians around the state about it, and they're very interested, so we'll be having meetings with those folks to say what other kind of system can we come up with that will largely be run in the private sector, with the public sector only doing very minimal regulatory type oversight, which is our job to be sure people uphold and obey the law, not to run healthcare. So we're working on that because something will need to happen. Healthcare is going to be a disaster in Wyoming in 2 or 3 years.
Right. Okay, thank you very much.
Well, thank you for
the call. Appreciate your phone call. We really do. We have another caller trying to get in. Hello, you're connected.
Hey, Dr. Haynes, how are you today?
Great. Thank you for asking. How are you?
I'm doing pretty swell. One thing, obviously, you've thought about, in order for people to have health care coverage outside of the state, you'd have to have a good provider relations network where they could, the providers would actually sign on with your network, and that way they would be covered as a participating provider. That way they wouldn't lose coverage outside the state of Wyoming.
That's right.
So let me ask you this. That's health care. We could talk about that all day. Let me ask you this, Dr. Haynes. If you were the governor, or should I say when you become the governor, you were talking about the EPA, and we know that they have a lot of power, much like the IRS has a lot of power that's not really delegated by the Constitution. As far as federal funding goes, and I might be opening up a big can of worms here, if you were governor, how would you fight these battles and temptation to withstand the EPA and possibly take recourse of the consequences of not having that federal funding? Now, I know you could probably give a quick answer, but I think the listeners would like to know kind of some specifics, if you can, within 5 minutes or a couple, 3 minutes or whatever. Get some specifics out there. Give us an idea of what you would do, and I know your lines are probably lit up, so I'm going to take your call off the air, sir.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
And we're at the top of the hour. We'll just pick up that answer right on the other side. Folks, don't go away. We will be right back.
KGAB Orchard Valley Cheyenne. Online at KGAB.com. AM 650 KGAB. A Wild Preps radio station.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the John Fenthaway Show. It's Bruce here standing in for our good friend, John. We've got in the studio with us Taylor Haynes, and he is running for governor of the great state of Wyoming. And we're taking calls right now for him, with him. And we've got a caller on the line, but caller, if you could just hold for a split second, because Taylor was wanting to answer the question of the prior caller, and we don't want to short-circuit that. And so you just hold for a split second. And Taylor, what say you on that last question?
Well, the next question is, how then would I be able to get along without federal funds, was just the question. And very easily, we will take over management of all of our lands, including all of our mineral wealth, and so we don't need any federal funds. And then the real question that he wanted, more than a quick answer, which I just gave to. And the reason I can do that, first of all, is Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution outlining what the federal government can own, and that's never been changed. Now, that's obviously been challenged. And one of the landmark decisions, not the only one, but the one I like the best because of the clarity of the language of the justice writing for the majority opinion, and that's Pollard v. Hagen, 44 U.S. 3, Hal, page 212 to 221, 1845. And the gist of this case was the justice writing the opinion said that the United States, while it managing a territory, has all sovereign rights. Once that territory becomes a state, all of those rights are relinquished, and that state comes into the Union on the same footing as its other 13 colonies, which had no federal land. And the reason they had no federal land is because of Article 1, Section 8 of the United States Constitution. And that's really why you don't need another court case, and you don't even need to pass a bill. A governor can simply say that federal land management contracts in the state of Wyoming are canceled.
Okay, you know what? I think what strikes me, Taylor, and I might be wrong on this, but it just seems that you know your cases so well. You know your history so well. You know the Constitution so well. If I was opposing you, I mean, I'd find it tough to argue against that. It seems to me that the rank and file media public now, the popular culture, is just totally disconnected with those things.
That's right, and that's really where we're in jeopardy. Is our public has not been taught the Constitution and have not followed or been taught how to research decisions that have solidified that document as the grand law of the land. And that will be my job as governor, not only to enact the Constitution, but be sure that people understand where that authority comes from, and I'm not just governing by fiat, which is what we're seeing now.
Sure. Fair enough. Hey, we've got another caller on the line. Go ahead. You're on the John Fenthaway Show. Welcome.
Yes. Good morning again. Well, good afternoon. It's Eric again. Good morning, Bruce and Dr.
Hello, Eric. Yeah. Good. Always good to hear you.
Okay. You know, I wanted to talk about, you know, as I read the Declaration of Independence, right, I can't help but seeing the parallel of when they refer to he
in the Declaration of Independence 18 times, meaning King George III, I can't help but seeing a parallel the same as he who occupies the Oval Office now. And especially when it comes to the 10th he, when it says, he has created a multitude of new offices and sent higher swarms of officers to harass our people and eat out their substance. Now, that is the Oval Office acting just like King George III, having all these different offices under his control, and the more he has under his control, the more of our constitutional rights disappear.
Okay, let's see what Taylor says about that. Yeah.
Well, you're right, Eric, and the most distressing part of that is Congress has put in place to prevent that, and they've not prevented it. They've gone along, they've abdicated. So, the next line of defense is your state government. That's your governor and your state legislators. If they don't stand up, you will see exactly what you're describing become more and more entrenched, and that's really an oligarchy. Even though it looks like Obama's a dictator, Congress is complicit. He has no authority to make the executive orders that he's made, many of them. He only has authority to enforce those things that the Constitution gives the executive branch power to do, and he's far overstepped that. And Congress even asked him for a waiver on Obamacare, which is just the most maddening, ludicrous thing in the world. Since they make the laws, his job is to enforce the law. They don't ask him for permission to change the law.
Right.
And so that's why we have to have state government stand up and says, okay, guys, here's the line, and it's drawn by the Constitution. We're going to respect federal authority as outlined by the Constitution, and you will respect state authority as outlined by the Constitution.
Yeah. Well, you see, here's the thing, Taylor, is that the fact still remains when you say states should stand up for their rights. When that Boston Marathon thing took place and how they locked down Boston, searched all the homes, told people to get the HVAC in the house or else, and even went into the homes and searched their homes, that's a picture of our future.
Not on my watch.
Right. I believe if you become governor of this state, that will never happen in this state, because I believe as you as governor will spread the truth and the Constitution, and the people will wake up to their constitutional rights rather than say, well, let's wait and see what happens. I don't think that's going to happen with you as governor.
You know what? We appreciate your call. We want to make sure we just get all these calls in here.
Yeah.
So thank you for chiming in.
Thanks, Eric.
That means a lot to us. And, you know, one of the things, I know we're going to get a light here in any second here, but one of the things that, in fact, there we go. We'll take this call. Hey, you're on the John Frentaway Show. We're glad you're with us. What's up?
Good morning. This is Chaplain Ron. Hello, Taylor.
Morning, Chaplain. How are you?
We're doing just fine, hunkering down for 2014. My motto for 14 is no more in 1-4. We're waking up. We're all waking up.
Actually, I kind of like that.
SF, I know. We're going to adopt it in Wyoming. No more in 1-4. SF-104, Taylor, was it legal or illegal for them to do that?
It was unlawful.
You
want to be careful with the term legal and illegal, okay?
Okay.
See, it could be legal because of statutory and maritime, which is separate from the Constitution. It was clearly unconstitutional, therefore unlawful.
Then whoever bangs the Constitution, especially at your level of influence, shouldn't they be backing Cindy Hill 100% until she has been eliminated through what I see from Lednow and this state attorney and everything else that Ross is doing, all this stuff that they're involved in, impeached? If she's impeached, that ends that. But then there's appeals, and God only knows what's going to take place. But, Taylor, shouldn't you be backing her, the Tea Party, everybody, 100% until this is a closed deal?
What we should be backing, Chaplain Ron, is the Constitution. And I lobbied to have Senate File 104 overturned at the legislature, and I traveled the state on my own nickel and carried petitions, but the petition process is so onerous we couldn't get it done. What people need to look at in 2014 is they should vote every senator and representative who comes up for election out if they voted for Senate File 104.
Yeah, and I just, you know, you're a warrior. Cindy's a warrior. We have an uphill climb because we have been asleep for so long. No more in 1-4. God bless us all.
God bless us all. And I hope
people will get out there
and vote.
You know, I believe, now Taylor, correct me if I'm wrong, but in order for someone to do what was just mentioned about, hey, I don't like what my representative and senator's done, I'm going to vote him out. Y-Watch, I believe, tracks all that. And so if you want to know who's voted for what, Y-Watch is an organization that is a true public service organization.
And it's on their website. That's right.
People know. You know, because you gotta make decisions with information. And, you know, the media, to me, you know, I see some sensationalism. I don't always see the information. I really need to make a decision. We have got another caller. Come on to us. Hello. That didn't come out right, but, hey, y'all know what I meant. Okay. What's up, man? You're on the air. Go ahead.
Hi. This is Dave Cronover. Taylor, I want to tell you that I'm for you for the mayor, for the governor of the state, and I hope that you get there. But I want to know if you understand something. The items that you're talking about real estate, and all the interstate government shouldn't be in the real estate business, and anything that they don't hold that concerns the military or the little area given them to build the capital should be returned to the states and should be the state's responsibility. EPA doesn't have any business even being in existence. That's an operation of the states, not the federal government, because you're too far away to know what the real problems are in a given state. And you can go on and on. But the fact is that the several items that you've been talking about here for the last hour are only the tip of the iceberg. Do you understand that there's probably over 400 items, and these are just insignificant parts of it. They're part of it, and we'll be dealing by it, but unless you deal with the whole problem, which involves more than 400 such items, and deal with, because it took us 200 years to get here, and it's not going to take one constitutional amendment to straighten it out. It's going to take a bunch of them, and it's going to take a bunch of states getting together and putting together a convention to put together some suggested constitutional amendments that the Congress will have to present to the people and will be adopted and will correct this thing. And if you don't address the whole thing, addressing the single items that you're addressing today won't slow down in any measurable effect our descent to destruction.
Okay. Some interesting thoughts expressed. Taylor, your thoughts, please.
Well, I understand your frustration, but a journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step at a time. And a constitutional convention and a bunch of constitutional amendments in front of a Congress that doesn't respect the present Constitution is a waste of time. What we have to do is fix our state. Once we fix our state, other states will, they're all looking for leadership. Other states, and I can name three off the top of my head, Idaho, Utah, and Oklahoma, will be right there beside us, and then so will Texas. And that's how we fix the country. You're right, it took 200 years to get here, and it's going to take a few things to get back. But first, if you're going to stop things going in the wrong direction, the first thing you do is stop. And the way you stop is you enforce the Constitution in your state, and then other states will come along behind.
All right. And folks, before we take this other call, and caller, I know you're connected, but just hold on for a second, please. The landscape of this is we've got Taylor until 12:30, in which case, after that, John is back, and he's got some things he wants to talk about with us, so we'll just really be happy to chime in with him. So, really, if you've got a question, we've got about 9 minutes if you want to ask Taylor a question on the air, just to let you all know. How that lay of the land is going. So, back to the phones. We've got a caller who's connected now. Welcome, you're on the John Frenthaway Show.
Yes, Bob East of town. The Wyoming voters a couple of years ago passed the Wyoming Health Care Freedom Amendment, which was supposed to protect us from all this Obamacare stuff. And as I recall, Dr. Haines, you were opposed to that. Maybe you can refresh our memory as to why that was. But what you know, we haven't heard a peep out of that amendment that was supposed to be protecting us from all this and doesn't seem to be doing it. So I'd like to get your take on what the impact of that is, and does it actually provide us with some protection?
Provides us with no protection, and that's why I was against it. The amendment was written, if you understand that your rights come from God, and the Constitution and government is supposed to protect your God-given rights, those amendments took that power away from God and gave it to the legislature. And we see how well that's worked. Now, what was supposed to happen is no Obamacare in Wyoming, no expansion of Medicare. And so in order to do that through the back door, they allow the feds to set up an exchange, which they can, but the state hasn't done really anything for those folks who've simply lost their traditional health insurance policies. And earlier you may have heard or not that my wife and I, my wife's a very well-educated and experienced person in healthcare benefit design, etc., and of course I have a medical background. We are working on a program that will circumvent this whole Obamacare nonsense, put healthcare in the private sector, but in a manageable, affordable, free market type way so the market will regulate itself. We pretty well have a framework for Wyoming, and we're working on a framework through our national PPO networks so that if we put this on the ground in Wyoming, then they'll be covered when they travel if they're injured or become ill. And that's really where we're going. These amendments did just what I said they'd do. They wouldn't do anything about Obamacare, but they did give the legislature more power in your life.
Thank you.
Any other thoughts before? Well, I guess that was his only thought for now. But folks, if you'd like to call, these calls are... they're unvetted. It is purely, you know, we want to hear what you think, one way or the other. Taylor, going into this election, what would you say your three top issues, two or three top issues would be?
Well, obviously, the top issue is always is overreach of the federal government,
okay,
and loss of constitutional rights, property rights, right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. And the second thing is the devastation of education. And then the third thing is education of our population to their constitutional rights, the power they have in their hands, and how they can go about exercising that. Those are my top three items.
Okay, very concise. I think I understand where you're coming from. We have got a caller on the line. Go ahead. I won't say come on to us. This time I'll say, hey, welcome.
Thank you. Happy New Year to you guys.
Happy New Year.
Taylor, you're wrong about one thing.
What's that?
The federal government isn't. It's the people. The people of the United States is the federal government, and they can own things. And the federal government represents them just like the state's supposed to. The 14th Amendment prevents any state from taking away the rights of the citizen of that state because he's a U.S. citizen in every state. And you are wrong. I don't know where you read the Constitution. It just sounded more and more like Obama to me in a dictator type of way.
Yeah, right.
That's all I get to say.
Well, thanks, Howard. You can read the 14th Amendment again or not, but you need to also read Article 1, Section 8. The people of the United States own 10 square miles of Washington, D.C. together in our 7 or 8 territories. They don't own, I don't own anything in Texas unless I bought it, and they don't own anything in Wyoming unless they bought it.
You know, folks, I'm just going to throw something here, and there's a dollar conversation, and I got about half a cent a comment here, but it seems to me that issue is a little bit academic. When I look at what is really happening, we have the federal government more and more every year dictating more and more things that they never got into. They're telling us what to do, and the media and others are basically... there's a mindset, and that is, you know what, if the feds say something, you'd better do it. What if the feds are wrong? What if they have no constitutional right to do that? And if we're asleep at the helm of this ship, it's going down. So
it's over. If you don't know your constitutional rights, you don't have it.
Right, right. We've got another caller on the line. Welcome. Hello.
Hey, good morning, Bruce. Good morning, Doc. Good
morning.
This is Frank from the South Side.
Hello, Frank, sir.
Well, Prince Henry shows that a little bit of knowledge is a dangerous thing. I took 2 years of constitutional law at undergraduate level, and 2 years of constitutional law at a graduate level, and I spent 3 years studying the Constitution, its origins, and development while in graduate school. And you're the only person I've ever met, Doc Haynes, that knows more about the Constitution than I do.
You're very kind, Frank.
Well, that's a true story. Congress shall exercise exclusive jurisdiction over an area not to exceed 10 miles square, as may be ceded by the several states, et cetera, et cetera. It's very, very clear. They don't own any land unless the state legislature grants it to them for those purposes enumerated in the Constitution.
That's right. And that's just, but you see, that hasn't been taught through the schools, and people have this wish for a king and this wish for an overarching government to protect them from what, I don't know, because they're protecting us from our God-given constitutional rights is what's happened. And so
that's
somebody
true.
That knows what's going on needs to stand up and say, no, here's the line, there's your authority, here's our authority, we're going to respect it on both sides.
You bet. I'll let you go and somebody else get in.
Thanks, good Frank.
Thank you very much. Frank from the South Side, I happily call him sir.
Yes.
You know what? This is part of our solution, is education. That level of education, that level of knowledge that I've so happily heard you both articulate so well on the airwaves. You know, that's getting folks to understand that is I think, part of the big solution. We've got another caller for Taylor. Go ahead.
An elected official, Cindy Hill, stood up and did exactly what Taylor just said. It was her elected duty to stand up for the Constitution, and she was eliminated. This is going to go down as something really awakening in Wyoming. No more in 1-4.
No more in 1-4. I think that's catchy. I'm for catchy things like
great.
That. Hey, we got about a minute. How can people get a hold of you, Taylor?
They can go to the website, HaynesForGovernor.com, and that information always filters through to me. And if they have questions, there's a place to ask questions, and there are some issues on the website. And be in mind that the website is actually being, this website that I'm giving you, HaynesForGovernor.com, will be replaced shortly with a more of the battle plan, shall we say. It's going to be upgraded.
Is there a phone number they can reach you at all? Or that's all on the
website? It's all on the website.
Okay, folks, sounds good to me. HaynesForGovernor.com?
Right.
Is that right? All right, we have been, I think, well-fed. And listen, appreciate the time.
Appreciate the time from you guys, Bruce. Thanks to you and John and KGAB. God be with us all.
Okay, we've got John Frenthaway coming up with the next half hour. Folks, don't go away. We will be right back.
Folks, back with John Frenthaway on KJB and the Frenthaway Forum for the last segment of our program today. And as we do every week, or try to do every week, we want to honor those who have fallen. And I hope that Taylor hung on, because I do have a call or a question to me with regard to him.
John Taylor is here.
Oh, good. Well, Taylor, when I get to that point, let me honor these individuals who have died throughout the month of December. I don't know that this is going to be all of them, because the last one I have was December 23rd, and I'm sure there's probably been some more deaths since that time in Afghanistan.
Unfortunately.
But I will review those ones who have given their life throughout the month of December, still in Afghanistan. And I'm just kind of hesitating, because I'm wanting to know whether I ought to read another. I think I will. This is a little poem I think many of you people have heard, but it points out what I want us to think about. Some of you may have read it before. It's called A Merry Christmas. It's actually written kind of along the lines of The Night Before Christmas. And then I want Taylor to answer a question. Taylor, you might be thinking about our military and those individuals who are serving for us, because I think there's a lot of unjust things going on for them, particularly right now. But let me just read this out so you folks can get into the right attitude that I'd like us to be in whenever we read the names of these people that have died. The embers glow softly in their dim light. I gazed around the room and I cherished the sight. My wife was asleep, her head on my chest, my daughter beside me. angelic in rest. Outside, the snow fell, a blanket of white, transforming the yard to a winter delight. The sparkling lights on the tree, I believe, completed the magic that was Christmas Eve. My eyelids were heavy, my breathing was deep, secure and surrounded by love. I would sleep in perfect contentment, or so it would seem. So I slumbered, perhaps I started to dream. The sound wasn't loud, it wasn't too near, but I opened my eyes when it tickled my ear, perhaps just a cough, I didn't quite know, then the sure sound of footsteps outside in the snow. My soul gray gave a tremble, I struggled to hear, and I crept to the door just to see who was near. Standing out in the cold and dark of the night, a lone figure stood, his face weary and tight. A soldier, I puzzled. Some 20 years old, perhaps a Marine, huddled here in the cold. Alone in the dark, he looked up and smiled, standing watch over me and my wife and my child. "What are you doing?" I asked without fear. "Come in this moment. It's freezing out here. Put down your pack. Brush the snow from your sleeve. You should be at home on a cold Christmas Eve." For barely a moment, I saw his eyes shift away from the cold and the snow blown in drifts to the window that danced with warm fire's light. He sighed and said, "It's really all right. I'm out here by choice. I'm here every night. It's my duty to stand at the front of the line that separates you from the darkest of times. No one had to ask or beg me or implore me. I'm proud to stand here like my fathers before me. My gramps died at Pearl on the day in December." Then he sighed, "That's a Christmas Grim always remembers. My dad stood his watch in the jungles of Nam, and now it's my turn, and so here I am. I've not seen my own son in more than a while, but my wife sends me pictures. He's sure got her smile." Then he bent and carefully pulled from his bag a red, white, and blue, an American flag. "I can live through the cold and the being alone, away from my family, my house, and my home. I can stand at my post though through the rain and the sleet. I can sleep in a foxhole with little to eat. I can carry the weight of killing another, or lay down my life with my sister and brother, who stand at the front against any and all to ensure for all time that this flag will not fall. So go back inside," he said. "Harbor no fright. Your family is waiting, and all be all right. But isn't there something I can do at the least? Give you money, I ask, or prepare you a feast? It seems all too little for all that you've done for being away from your wife and your son." Then his eyes welled a tear that held no regret. "Just tell us you love us and never forget to fight for our rights back home while we're gone. To stand your watch, no matter how long. For when we come home, either standing or dead, to know you remembered we fought and we bled is payment enough. With that we will trust, but we matter to you as you matter to us." And now the names for those who have given their life that we might have our freedom and our peace. Navy Petty Officer First Class James L. Smith was 38 years old from Huffman, Texas. He died on December the 11th in Landstuhl, Germany, from a combat incident. Marine Lance Corporal Matthew R. Rodriguez from Fairhaven, Massachusetts, died on December 11th while conducting combat operations in Helmand Province, Afghanistan. Army Staff Sergeant Jesse L. Williams, 30, of Elkhart, Indiana, died on December 17th in Nowbaer, Afghanistan, in a helicopter crash. Army Chief Warrant Officer 2, Joshua B. Silverman, 35, of Scottsdale, Arizona. Died on December 17th in Nowbair, Afghanistan, in that same helicopter crash. Army Specialist Terry K.D. Gordon, 22, of Shubuta, Mississippi, also died on December 17th in the same helicopter crash that took the lives of Warrant Officer 2 Randy L. Billings. Army First Sergeant Class, or First Class, Army Sergeant First Class Omar W. Forday, 28, of Marietta, Georgia, died on December 17th in the same helicopter crash. Army Sergeant Peter Bowler, 29, from Willow Spring, North Carolina, also died in the same helicopter crash, lost quite a few in that incident. Army Chief Warrant Officer 2, Randy L. Billings, died in the same helicopter crash. He was from Havener, Oklahoma, 34 years old. And Marine Sergeant Daniel M. Vaseline, 27, from Arlington, Massachusetts, died on December 23rd while conducting combat operations in Helmand Province, Afghanistan. I'm sure that that won't be all that have died in December by the time we get next week and get the names of those individuals. But these are the ones, along with the thousands and thousands more, who have sacrificed their lives while we remain safe. But I want to go back just to that one phrase, that as I welled a tear that held no regret, just tell us you love us and never forget to fight for our rights back at home while we're gone, to stand your own watch no matter how long. Those are for us, ladies and gentlemen. Those words are for us that are here. And the battle rages. Taylor, these people have given their lives, and thousands others who have gone and not come home, or some have come home, and are veterans who are now suffering, some who have given 20 to 30 years of their life and are retired. I'm very, very incensed at what Congress has done this last week with regard to trying to find some financial balance in our country, but shut the door and on our veterans. I can't understand that, Taylor. I know as the governor of the state of Wyoming, you can't control what the federal government does for those people who have served our constitutionally served our government, this the United States of America, to protect us. But certainly you'll have a voice in what should be done for those individuals and can advocate for their part. Could you tell us here before we go off the air, what would you do for those people who have served our country and are presently serving our country in the future as the governor of the state of Wyoming?
Well, in a short one, thanks, John, and thanks for that tribute to the fallen. First of all, in the short run, you have to take care of your veterans, the veterans that live in our state. We've got to be sure they're not suffering, that they're not taxed and dragged around like rag dolls, and that they're not homeless. And there are ways we can do that under the Constitution. But your point about having a voice, I will be in the room with other governors, and I will start out in the organization, the National Governors Association, the Western Governors Association. But I'll tell you, I'll be calling some meetings with specific governors who have demonstrated at least an interest in the Constitution, and have them come to Wyoming or have us have a meeting. And that's one of the first topics. because the effect and just the scandal of trashing our veterans is like planting some sort of disease. That does two things. It undermines military service, it undermines patriotism, and then it just poisons the well for those folks who actually have the calling to do what the Marine was doing in that poem you read. There are people called to protect us. They have that natural proclivity and they have a God-given ability to do that. And when we turn around and slap them in their face or spit in their face or say they're not important, well, we undermine that. We cause confusion and introduce additional chaos in our society. So as governor, I will always champion our veterans and champion military service. And I will also go to the next level to protect our particular military people here in Cheyenne and in Wyoming, and I will resist and prevent them from serving in any war not declared by Congress. The War Powers Act is unconstitutional, and we will not honor that. So that's really the short answer, and in the short run, what I'll do.
You know, Taylor, as I've listened to your comments, and I was listening when I wasn't here on the phone, to the statements that you had and the responses that you had to the callers, and I want to say this to you personally, that you display, in my mind, a very broad range of understanding that, quite honestly, I don't think our present governor has had. I don't think that any former governors recently have. In just about every area that the questions have come to you today, I'm not implying, nor do I want to insult you as someone who believes he knows everything, because I know you personally, and I know that you don't feel that way, and I know that you would be the person that whenever you find yourself in a situation of lesser confidence in a certain area, you would find those people that do know that can inform you. But your ability to read, your ability to become educated in an area is tremendous also, so that you can find the basics of any particular topic that you need to find out about. And the other thing that I know about you personally is that you will take the time to do it. It's not a political thing that you're seeking after here. It's not something that Taylor Haynes needs for some type of future epitaph to be written on his gravestone. And I can honestly say this for you, Taylor, is that you are running for this office. And to run for this office for you is actually a personal sacrifice. You're not at a time in your life, or you are a time in your life, when others would say, "Oh, Taylor, it's time for you to be retiring." And I'm not trying to compare you to the absolutes of all the other great men that have gone before, but it does remind me of Washington whenever he wanted to retire and go back to Mount Vernon and spend his life, but yet he came back, became the President of the United States, and continued to lead this country into the success that we are at this particular time. Taylor, in the few minutes that we have left, and we don't have much time, why? Why are you doing this?
Well, thanks for those kind words, Jones. I have no choice. The Lord's pushing me, and the benefit of all of my experience in business and the unusual education that I've had, it's clear to me that these weren't just for my personal use and personal aggrandizement. And to tell you the truth, from a selfish point of view, John, all of those things that we stand for, hold dear, and want are in danger. That includes those things which are the same things that I stand for and hold dear. Life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, to have an own property, to be free to think, worship, pray as I choose. I see every one of those things being jeopardized, and not down the road. They're in trouble right now. They're in trouble right here in Cheyenne, Wyoming. And so if I see that, and I know that it can be fixed, and I know that there's a better way, then I'm stuck. I had a responsibility of using my God-given gifts and blessings to fix those things, to lead the charge. All of us together will have to work together to do it, but I promise you I'll lead the charge. So that's really why I'm running, John, because of all the things I've seen wrong. And the education and business experience that I've had, I know these things can be done in a better way.
Well, Taylor, that's a pretty direct answer to what my question was. And I hope that those of you that are listening to Taylor talk, understand that by electing Taylor Haynes to be the governor of this state isn't going to fix all the problems. Taylor can't do it entirely by himself. He said he'll lead the charge, and that's the person out that's in front that's carrying the flag that will hopefully cause an excitement in the rest of us to do what we have to do. But in order to do that, we have to have the same attitude that he has, which is not for ourselves, not for our own self-aggrandizement. We need to recognize the children, our grandchildren, and those children who are not yet on this earth, who need to have the same liberties and rights that we have. This country is leading the charge. It always has led the charge for liberties and those God-given rights. As Taylor said, the life of life, liberty, the rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. He's leading the charge, and he's got the ability to find the course that's going to be beneficial for all of us. But he alone cannot do it. We can't sit idly by and figure that just by voting for him, everything's over and done. We have to pretty much keep our nose to the grindstone and our shoulder to our wheel, to the wheel, so that we can continue to help him and help our children and our children's children to the freedoms and the rights and the liberties that our founding fathers suffered and died for in years past. The battle is still out there, and we need to continue to fight the fight so that we can show that we have an appreciation for those that die, but also an appreciation for those who are yet to live. Taylor, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thank you, John. Thank you.
We pray God's blessing upon you and to your family to have a glorious new year. 2014 is a big year. It's a big year for all of us.
Amen.
And you're more than welcome to come back whenever you feel like you can and join us. And hopefully you're able to answer more questions as you have done today. And we hope that the people have appreciated the time that you've taken to come and show to us the interest and the true reasons for why you're running for this office. I have it on pretty good information, Taylor, that you have a wonderful life and a wonderful family. If you're not governor of the state of Wyoming, your life is still going to be pretty good, except for the fear of what might come if you're not the governor. And I know personally of you that it's not for your own personal self. So thank you so much for the sacrifice that you're making, and I hope all of you that have listened to the program today will join us again whenever Taylor comes, and we'll be back next week. I'm not sure exactly how much time we got, but it can't be too much.
We have about 2 minutes, John, 2 minutes.
Well, I just want to say this to all of you. As I said earlier in the program, the success of this country is blessed by people such as Taylor and all of our founding fathers that have gone before us, but it rests upon us. Each of us, and the value of life and the value that we place upon life, not just in the honoring of each of us as individuals and life in of itself, but the way that we live life. And I suggest highly that you find those values and sets of values that will best support you in your support of the liberties that God has given to us, because they are not given to us by our government. I strongly suggest, and from my own experience of 65 years, can say unequivocally that those teachings that are given to us out of the Bible, those teachings that Jesus gave to us, are fundamentally those types of values that each of us have to apply in our lives. And we have to do it individually, not by force or constraint, but willingly, of a willing mind, to be able to serve our fellow man and show compassion. And if you're sitting in a day of depression, or your life seems to be upside down and in turmoil, give service to your fellow man. Find someone out there that is less than you, and that is not hard to do. Give service, give a handout to help those people up. Not to take care of them, but as the poet once said, to teach them how to fish, not to give them a fish. And you'll find that all the challenges in your life will dissipate, and you'll be a stalwart member of society in a way that benefits everyone that is around you. So God bless you all. Have a happy new year this year. We'll talk to you next week. Taylor, again, thank you so much for coming. And Bruce, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Sitting in.
Thank you, John.
And God bless you all.
See you all next year.
That's right.
KGAB Orchard Valley Cheyenne. On air at AM 650, worldwide at KGAB.com. A Wild Preps radio station.